is Erica, and today I'm going to be talking to you about some of the bookish tropes that you find in YA novels. Honestly, bookish tropes are found in any type of genre, but particularly YA, I tend to notice them the most, and they're usually the most annoying. I made my own list of bookish tropes I don't like, but then I also researched about other bookish tropes that I may have forgotten, and so I'm just going to be running through that list and talking to you guys about what those tropes are and whether or not I like them or hate them. The first one is insta-love. I hate insta-love. I just can't stand it. I like when there's conflict. I like when the characters have to work for their relationships. I feel like it's a lack of creativity on the writer's part, and it just doesn't give the characters a lot of development, and the story kind of loses a lot to it. Insta-love to me is an easy way out in terms of building the relationship between the characters. Enemies to lovers, another trope I absolutely cannot stand. It was so weird because last year when I was doing Booktubeathon and a little before then, I ended up reading a lot of books that had this trope in it, like Defy. Daughter of Smoke and Bone also was like enemies to lovers, and I hated that. What other book? There's just been a lot of books that I read last year that made me not want to read YA for a really long time, honestly. Like, I got so annoyed of the enemies to lovers trope, and somehow every book I chose had that trope in it, and I wasn't doing a good job picking out which books I wanted to read because they all had that trope, and I got really tired of it. Like, it's just so boring to me. I don't know. A lot of love tropes that I really can't stand, apparently, anymore. The next one on my list is the chosen one trope. Now, with this trope, basically, there's a character who was chosen to save the world, and there are a lot of books with this type of trope in it. And I can't say that I love it, but I also can't say that I hate it. It's kind of more in between. Some books, you do need the chosen one in it. Like, I mean, honestly, the book that I plan on writing kind of has the chosen one trope in it. Like, I feel like that has to be built up, and then... But, I mean, of course, Harry Potter is, like, a chosen one story. Frodo in The Lord of the Rings, that's a chosen one story. Bobby Pendragon in the Pendragon series, that's a chosen one story. There's a lot of chosen one stories. If they're written well, then they're fine. But if they're not, and the character's annoying, then it's not as interesting to me. But that trope is one that I don't particularly hate, but I don't, like, love. It's just, I feel like it's necessary sometimes, but it's not something that, like... I look for in a book. This one isn't really a trope, it's kind of like a writing thing. It's like when they say a breath they didn't know they were holding. I never used to notice it until Jesse, on Jesse the Reader, he brought it up that Sarah J. Maas says it a lot. When I was rereading them, I noticed it so much, and it really started to bother me, but I mean, that's just like, I feel like a normal thing that a lot of people write, but I did notice it a lot in Sarah J. Maas's novels, so that was just something, like, I don't hate it, but I don't love it. It's another one that's just kind of there. And sometimes you're like, oh yeah, like, you can feel that too, but that's just, like, another, like, writing thing that kind of annoys me. The next one on my list is secret royalty. I feel like it happens a lot in, like, Hallmark movies, but also, like, The Princess Diaries, which I love that movie, so that's not a problem. If it's not written badly, then it's fine. Paper Princess by Erin Watt, that book I hated so much. And it's not like she was, like, born into, like, royalty, but she was, like, adopted into, like, this rich family, and... It was just a horrible book. I gave that 1 star, but it deserved, like, -5 stars, to be honest. That's another thing that bothered me a lot about Sarah J. Maas's books. A lot of her books, like, a lot of her characters in every story, you find out, oh, they're actually this person, and then you're just kind of like, why? Is this necessary? Like, can we not? This one's kind of, like, a weird pet peeve, like, in writing, when eye descriptions are always... brought up. That is a huge thing in Cassandra Clare's books. Perfect Blue Eyes. I think it's blue. I don't even remember. The green. One of her family of characters all have the exact same eyes, and she always brings it up. Like, every other description. Oh, they're piercing sapphire eyes or something like that. And that just, like, we get it. We get what their eyes look like. I don't need you to re-describe it to me 115 times because I know these characters by now because I've followed them for all these years. It's just... We don't need it all the time. I get, like, bringing it up once or twice in a description about the character, but when it's, like, every time you describe the character, I'm done. So that's a big pet peeve of mine when it comes to tropes. Oh, another one, the sacrificial protagonist. Now, I've actually read a lot of books with this type of trope. I feel like, especially recently, I'm not gonna say which books because I don't want to spoil anything. The sacrificial protagonist bothers me because you fall in love with this character through the entire story. In the series, and then all of a sudden you're told that they have to be the ones to sacrifice themselves in order to save everybody else. That's also kind of reminds me of, like, the chosen one, because it's, you just, I don't know, you build this relationship with this character just for the author to go and, like, let them die. Like I keep saying, if it's written well, then I can get past it, but if it's not and it's just, like, an easy way out for the writer to just kill off this character and save everyone, then I have a problem with it. That's also kind of like a Deus Ex Machina, which is another bookish trope that I'm not really a huge fan of. Basically, the Deus Ex Machina is something that just automatically saves everyone. Like, you build up the whole story, and the stakes are super high, and you make this conflict, but then all of a sudden something saves the day immediately without even, like, having to worry. Kind of like the Eagles in the Lord of the Rings, I feel like they're kind of a Deus Ex Machina type, because they come in, they save everybody from a disaster, or they take everyone to safety, and that's like an easy way out. I'm not saying that's bad, like I feel like the Eagles are a huge part, and I love the Lord of the Rings, of course. If it's not written well, or it's just kind of lazy writing, then I definitely don't support it, and it just kind of takes me out of the story and makes me like regret reading it in a way sometimes. Here we are, love triangles. Okay, so love triangles, I feel like I actually don't really mind. I know a lot of people hate love triangles, but sometimes they're just really interesting. My favorite love triangle of all time is in the Infernal Devices between Tessa, Jem, and Will. Like, ugh, just thinking about it, I need to reread those books. I find their love triangle to be one that was written beautifully. All of their characters, like, it's just so good. And I have no problem with them. I remember when I first read it, it did kind of annoy me, and like, oh, just pick one. But then when you meet Tessa, and you see her with Jem, and you see her with Will, and you're like, oh my gosh, I don't know who to ship her with. Like, there's just special aspects of both of them that you just want her to have. And anyone who's read that book, that trilogy is just so beautiful. And I honestly think that Cassandra Clare did an amazing job creating a love triangle that I could easily support. A love triangle that I wasn't a huge fan of was Trick, Ashlyn, and Mia in the Nevernight Chronicles. That one, I mostly ship Ashlyn and Mia, you know, but it didn't really bother me about Trick. There's just a lot of love triangles that I support, so I don't hate it in a book, but I'm not gonna be like, yeah, I need to have a love triangle, because honestly, romance in novels lately have been really bothering me, but I don't really mind a love triangle if it's written well. The next one I have on here is absent families. So pretty much in most books, like, the family isn't present. That doesn't really bother me. Like, it is a trope, it does happen a lot, because honestly, sometimes family gets in the way, but most of the time it's like the parents are dead. Which is pretty common, but that's, I guess, the way the character has to, like, live their life, and that's just, I don't know, that gives them purpose, I think. Yeah, it's weird, there are a lot of books where there's, like, no family involved, and I haven't really thought about it. I guess if you read, like, contemporary, they're normally there, but, like, fantasy and sci-fi, there's not always, like, a huge family aspect to it, but it doesn't really bother me. It's not, like, a trope I don't like. I guess it's just something that I feel like is normal in books now. The next on my list I have is perfect characters. This one bothers me a lot. And this is why Sarah J. Maas's writing is kind of problematic to me. Her characters all have to be perfect and tall, lean, beautiful, like they have no flaws. All of her characters are like high fae or just royalty in general. I do love like her character a lot for the most part. I just think it's problematic that there's just no diversity in there and that there's no flaws really and that they all just have to be perfect. People can't see themselves in that world and they can't see themselves being like those characters. It's not really fitting to a lot of readers, and it's not fair to read books like that because it's not usually normal. I understand that it's fantasy and whatnot, but it's not always nice to have books that are written like that. What I love about Six of Crows and Crooked Kingdom is you have diverse characters who are different shapes and sizes, and that's why I love that book so much, because all those characters are different and they're all unique. They have quirks and flaws, and it's just, you can relate to them. I have to be able to relate to my characters once in a while. The next one I have is lack of platonic relationships in writing. Y'all, friendship is important. I get so sick of reading books where they're just focused on the romance between characters and not the friendship. The one problem I have with Truth Witch by Susan Dennard is the fact that it's supposed to be focusing on Issal and Safi's like friendship and their relationship, but instead they get like split up at the beginning of the book. And of course they get paired with men, so it's going to be focused more on their relationship and their romance with them rather than the friendship that I was like so excited about reading. I haven't finished that series, I don't even really remember what all happened so far, but I was really disappointed because Safi and Issal have such a cute relationship and their friendship is so beautiful, but you don't really get that in the book because it's going to be focusing more on separate stories for them, and I just hate that. When I went to BookCon, Susan Dennard and Sarah J. Maas and a couple others were talking about the importance of female relationships in books. However, Sarah J. Maas doesn't really have a lot of female friendships in her books. She has like a couple, but then every single person has to have a mate as well. So I feel like we get more romance than like the friendships. She did get a lot better about making people like have friends in her books, but at the same time, I roll my eyes every time they're like, oh, we are paired up now, like we're mates, like all this stuff. Like, give me a break. Just let them be friends. We can't just have friends in books. I hate it. I can't stand when there's no friendship and it's all about like everyone falling in love with each other. Oh, so that's pretty much all of the bookish tropes I have written down. There are a few more that I have, but I feel like I don't need to talk about all of those. There are a lot of tropes that you find while reading. I said a lot in this that if they're written well, it doesn't really bother me. That really depends, especially on like if the characters are written well, the story, the plot, if it makes sense. Honestly, lately, I haven't really been a big fan of reading YA because of these tropes. The enemies to lover one really took me out of reading for a really long time, and I just really have to find books that don't always have these tropes. Yeah, there's always going to be tropes in any book you read. That's just like a common thing. Like, every book is going to be similar in some way. There's always going to be something while you're reading that you may not agree with, but it's not going to make it a bad book. But there are just a lot of things that I've been reading lately that I just can't really get into. So, I don't know. Tropes are hit or miss. If you like the tropes that I said I didn't like, it doesn't matter. Like, we all have different opinions, and it's really what you enjoy reading. I can't tell you what to like or dislike, but there's just some things in books that I can't really get behind that do really take me out of a story. So that's pretty much it. That's all I have for you guys today. If you like this video, be sure to give it a nice little thumbs up. If you want to keep following me on this BookTube journey, please subscribe to my channel. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Erica A. Gobble. Thank you guys so much for watching. I'll see you soon with another video. Bye!